Hello, and welcome to this series of daily reflections during this Lenten season. I'm Bill Kerley, one of the pastors here at St. Paul's. As Jesus went about having his ministry of teaching and healing and doing wondrous signs, both he and his message grew in popularity. He talked about a way of relating to sacred mystery that did everything from challenge to make fun of the power and authority of Rome. As this went on, he drew the ire of both the religious and the political leaders. Word of his teachings and deeds grew, as did his influence. His popularity among some grew, not all. So did resistance against him. And then one day, he went into the temple. Now, I don't know what image comes to your mind when you hear the phrase, he went into the temple. Actually, the scripture says he went into the temple area, which is a very large space, large enough actually to accommodate 34 football fields. Into that space, on the high Jewish holy days, Passover, Pentecost, and the Feast of Tabernacle, thousands of people would gather. And included in the mix would be not only the pilgrims who gathered for such occasions, but also those who sold sacrificial animals, people who exchanged and made money available so that pilgrims could buy what they needed there rather than bring them long distances from home. The temple priest and the temple police would, of course, also be there. Now, I'm assuming most of you who would be viewing a video like this are familiar with the story. Jesus goes into the temple, looks around, sees what's going on, and causes a ruckus. He's quoted as saying, "Don't the scriptures say my house is to be regarded as a house of prayer for all peoples? But you have turned it into a hideout for crooks." These words are actually a mixture of lines from Isaiah and Jeremiah. What he said not only brought attention to himself, but contributed to the increasing anger the religious leaders had toward him. If you want to paraphrase the essence of what he said that day, you could reduce it to one word: stop. Stop what you're doing. Stop what you're allowing to happen. I have a fairly good hunch that a few decades after the execution of Jesus, and long before any of the gospel narratives were written, that those people who were newly attracted to the community of these joyful, fearless, forgiving Jesus followers would ask, "Why was Jesus executed?" And someone would perhaps respond, "Well, let me tell you about the day he went into the temple." I once heard an interview with one of my spiritual heroes, Thich Nhat Hanh. He was asked by the interviewer, "What's your spiritual practice?" And Thich Nhat Hanh answered in response, "My spiritual practice is being here." The temple incident, whatever happened, was the equivalent of a Zen master ringing the bowl or clapping his hands. It served to get people's attention, calling them into the here and now. This moment, right here, right now, this precious moment. This moment has never been. This moment will never be again. This moment, Jesus goes into the temple area, and he does and says something. It marks the beginning of the end for him. What he taught was that by paying attention to what is really going on, and to who we really are is the end of life as we know it, and the beginning of life and lives we are called to. This is what this Lenten season offers us the opportunity to do, to stop business as usual, to pay attention, to make sure that the path we are traveling is the one we say we're traveling and the one we're called to travel. So stop. Let us now enter into a period of prayer.
O God, who brought us forth from dust, and who is our guide through the wilderness, we pray for these your people, and this your creation. Give us grace to do your will in all that we cease or undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. O God, in your loving grace, hear our prayer. Turn our hearts toward you, and make our souls to dance in your loving kindness. Transform what is closed in us, and open it toward you. O God, in your loving grace, hear our prayer. Bind us together in a common life with those who are afflicted with unjust sorrow. Grant us solidarity that pursues a healing liberation for our neighbors and ourselves. O God, in your loving grace, hear our prayer. You turned strangers into disciples who spoke eagerly of your goodness and deliverance. Cause it to be so for us as well. O God, in your loving grace, hear our prayer. We offer these petitions through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.